In this video, we're going to do a few examples related to the intermediate value theorem. Before we begin, let's just quickly recap what the intermediate value theorem said. It says if your function's continuous on a closed interval, so there's no breaks in the function or anything like that defined on a closed interval, then for any y value between f of a and f of b, like I've drawn here, anybody, so we'll call it k, there has to be some x value called c such that f of c gives you that y value. So you can see my picture here. If I chose this to be my k, then here's the c value that would map to it. So f of c would be k right here. But on the other hand, if k was maybe like up here, then there would be a different value c that would map to it, or f of c would be k. You kind of have to look for it. But because my function's continuous, I know that I get every y value. So there it is. There's my c. Every y value between f of a and f of b, we get them all. That's basically what it says. All right. So let me start with just some general comments, and then we'll look at a specific example. All right. So here's a function 2 over x minus 3. Right. Now, as soon as I see that, red flags start going off in my head, because I automatically see that this guy's not continuous everywhere, because I see that he has a vertical asymptote at 3, so that's something to be careful about. But what they're likely to ask us is the intermediate value theorem applicable on for a given function on a given interval? So let's try this for two separate intervals here. So if we define f on the interval from 1 to 7, if that's my a to b, is the intermediate value theorem applicable on this closed interval? And the answer is no. The answer is no. Now, why is it not applicable on this interval? Well, one of the requirements was that your function had to be continuous on the interval from 1 to 7. And like we said earlier, there was an asymptote at 3, right? 3 gives you division by 0, and there's an asymptote here. So it's not continuous on that interval. Now, what if we re-ask the question on the interval from 5 to 7? This function still has an asymptote, but there's a difference. The asymptote is not between 5 and 7. So if you look at my graph, between 5 and 7, the function is actually fine. So is the intermediate value theorem applicable? Well, between 5 and 7, yes, it is. It is applicable there. Okay, so there's just a couple of comments there. Now, let's look at a specific example. We'll keep the same function, f of x equals 2 over x minus 3. Then is the intermediate value theorem applicable on the closed interval from 4 to 11? And that answer is yes, it is, because the asymptote at 3 is not in the interval we're looking at. It's continuous on the interval from 4 to 11. And so if so, let's try to find the value of c that satisfies the intermediate value theorem if they provide us a y value of 1. All right, now the first thing we have to check is to see is 1 right here, is this 1 between f of 4 and f of 11, right? Because we have to see if it's between the first y value and the second y value. 4 and 11 are x values, but I can find f of 4, the y value at 4, by plugging it in. 2 over 4 minus 3, I think that's 2. And I also need to find f of 11. Let's try that. 11 minus 3 is 8. 2 divided by 8 is 1/4. And so we need to ask ourselves on a scale between a fourth and 2, is 1 somewhere in that scale? Because if the k value was outside that range, the intermediate value theorem still doesn't make sense, because we're supposed to be asking about y values between f of a and f of b. And it is. Yeah, so 1 is between 1/4 and 2. So there should be an x value somewhere. Where, I don't know, but there should be an x value that such that f of c gives me 1. Right, now, how do I find that? What do I do exactly? Well, what I do is I'll take this function here. Right, I'll take this guy, and I'll come down here, and I'll actually set the function 2 over x minus 3, and I'll ask the question, where is this equal to 1? And there should be an x value that gives me 1. So we have to do a little algebra. A little algebra here. Let's multiply x minus 3 to the right. So 2 equals x minus 3. Let's add 3 to the left. Okay, so we'll get x equals 5. And I'll reverse that order there. But yeah, x equals 5. So this is the value of c as 5. That's the x coordinate, the x value, that satisfies the intermediate value theorem, because I know that there should have been an x value that f of that x value gives me 1. Now, just a quick double check here. Is 5 on the interval from 4 to 11? Yes, it is. Now, occasionally, it didn't happen in this example, but occasionally what will happen is you start to solve this equation here, and maybe it's a quadratic equation instead of linear like mine. If you get two x values, you know how, you know, when you factor a quadratic, sometimes you'll get two factors, you know, equal to zero or what have you. Maybe your answers at the end of the problem will be 5 and 12, for example. Well, you don't list both of them. What you have to do is you have to see which of those x values is in the interval, right? And so you would say 5, because 5 is in the interval from 4 to 11. Don't give extra answers, even if they make the function equal the k value, if they fall outside of your interval. So there's an example. So hopefully that helps solidify the concept of the intermediate value theorem in your head, and also kind of get you started and help you understand what kind of questions might be asked of you when dealing with the intermediate value theorem.